You see a lot of young people in their 20s,
yeah,
early 30s that are striving for that. And they're striving for it fast.
Yeah.
They're striving for it, you know, I just graduated college and now I want to get there in the next couple of years. What do people in their 20s not understand about making money or reaching millionaire status that they really need to know before they hit that?
So I will probably answer this differently than you expect. I believe that sex is colorblind, age blind, everything blind, because there are certain activities that you have to do. If you do the activities, you can get the outcome. Now, if you're in your 20s, it's very difficult to do the amount of activities for a long enough period of time in order to get that. Now, you know, you've got Ben Francis, who started Gymshark when he was, whatever, 16 or 17 years old, and he's 28, it was worth over $1 billion. So he was in his 20s and it was, you know, he made a $1 billion company. Is that the exception? For the most part, yeah. That's not as common. You know, I became a millionaire when I was 26. 26 or 27, I can't remember. It was between 26 and 27 is when I became, when I had my first $1 million in my bank account. And so, but I started business when I was 22. And so I still had 5 years in. And now that's still fast. Don't get me wrong, it's still fast. But the accumulation of knowledge, because I spent almost all of my excess income on education. And so I wanted to pay down my ignorance tax as fast as I possibly could. And so rather than buy the Bentley or buy the watch so that I could flex on it, I still lived in a, split a room in a house with six other people while I was making $20,000 a month take home, because I wanted to have all that money so I could go on the offense if I wanted to go to a seminar or buy a course or go to a workshop or whatever it was, so that I could uplevel my skills and get there faster. And so I think the idea that you want to get there fast is fine. It's just having a realistic expectation of how many skills you need to acquire to get there. Because if you have all the skills, because I think we'll have continuously younger and younger and younger millionaires and billionaires that are going to continue to happen, because now a viral idea, I mean, Taylor Swift was 16 when she started recording music. That was a long time ago, right? She's 33 now. Now she's a billionaire.
You keep showing up consistently, right? And building it.
Mr. Beast is a billionaire. Yeah. He's 24.
Crazy.
So like it's going to continue to go down as the access to education increasingly gets democratized, so more people can access it for free. And so a nine-year-old can watch. Like, there's nothing that stops a nine-year-old from making and running a Facebook app. There's nothing. Like, and usually they're more tech savvy anyways.
Maybe they just got to get a credit card or something.
Sure, yeah, yeah.
That's a parent, yeah.
Yeah, and so there, but if we break it down to like the physics,
right,
or the
right.
action,
it's not that hard.
There's nothing that prevents people. And so I think that the level of competition will continue to rise. I think young people are more tech savvy, and so will in general have a continuously improving competitive advantage over older people, because the rate of technological change hastens, goes faster. And so the advantage of being young versus old is actually, I think, going to continue to expand, because tech moves so fast now that I think there will be more.
What do you think about, I mean, I had a mentor once told me when I was 24, when I was broke on my sister's couch, and I was living for free.
Yeah.
I was not paying rent. I was, you know, eating leftovers. Good life, man. And I remember saying to a mentor, I was like, man, I could really use some money right now. Like, I could really figure out how to make some more money.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, money comes to you when you're ready for it. I was like, I feel pretty ready.
Sorry.
And he goes, yeah, it could come, you know, maybe you get it and you're not ready and you lose it all,
mm-hmm,
because you're not emotionally ready.
Yeah.
So what advice do you have to people in their 20s who want to make a lot of money, but if they're not emotionally ready, what might happen to them?
Everything is trainable. And so if we define handling money as a skill, then it can be learned. And so if you, and you can look at anything, like if you were somebody who continues to hop from thing to thing to thing to thing to thing and you can't stick with it, it's usually because you don't have the skill of sticking with something. You haven't been rewarded enough in the past for staying with something, or you haven't been burned enough from starting over. Like on your fifth time of starting yet another thing and not getting deep enough on it, you have to think to yourself, maybe this isn't the right way to do it. I love giving this kind of like S-curve analogy, which hopefully your audience will enjoy. But there's five stages as I see it as somebody goes through the entrepreneurial journey when they're starting out. In the beginning, you've got the midline, right, where they start. Step one is they go above the midline and they go to uninformed optimism. They see the grass on the other side, it looks greener, and they're like, my buddy's doing drop shipping and he's making all this money,
right.
And that's gonna be me. And then they buy the course, they start watching videos, they start to connect things break, they, you know, buy some inventory, they don't know how much to buy, and all of a sudden they go to the point two, which is now below the line, which is informed pessimism.
This says hard.
Yeah, they find out all the things that they didn't know in the beginning. They paid down some ignorance debt, but there's still more to pay. And they're like, okay, wow. So they keep going because they're like, I gotta figure this out. And then they go to point three, which is the valley of despair, right? Which is where they're like, this isn't gonna work. This is never gonna work. And one of the hardest costs, and this is like what entrepreneurship feels like, if I can give it to anyone who's new to this, is the feeling of uncertainty that you don't know if all of the work that you've been spending all of your nights and weekends and off time investing in will ever pay off. And so it's this fear that you're wasting your time. But the reality is that the outcome isn't the thing that you're building. The person you are is the person that you're building, and that continues to work. And so there's a proverb in the Bible, I'm going to butcher it, but I think it's in all labor there is profit. And you can rephrase that as, it's the work works on you more than you work on it.
Say it again.
The work works on you more than you work on it. And so it's about who we become while doing the work more than the outcome from the work itself. Because like I lost everything 5 years into my entrepreneurial journey, but I still had all the skills and beliefs that I had from before that. And then I was able to reapply those and then have a really, you know, big outcome in what we have today. And so I remember when I lost everything that first time, I thought, did I just lose 5 years of my life? Like I just moved back, I'm at ground zero again. But I wasn't, because I had all these skills that I had learned, you know, owning and scaling six gyms at that point. And so point one, uninformed optimism. Point two, informed pessimism. Point three, value despair. And then go to point four, which is informed optimism. So now you do have a lay of the land. You understand that there's some skeletons. You do have to understand how you manage some inventory. You got to get ahead of some of stuff, but you learn how to forecast. You can know that weekends you tend to do better and weekdays you tend to do less. And so you can dial back support on those days and dial it up on the other days. You start to recognize patterns. And so you start to know what you're doing, right? You're paying down all the ignorance debt. And then finally, step five is you achieve whatever the original goal was. But the problem is that most people go step one, two, three, and then they jump back to step one.
With something new.
Right. And so they go to yet again, the grass is greener on the other side, but what they don't know is that it's still fertilized with manure. They're still on the other side too. And so there's always everywhere.
Let me get into real estate now. Let me get into this.
Right.
I'm going to
do wholesaling and day trading. Yeah. Right. Of course, there's all these, you know, quick make money things. But if you look at the people who are making the most money in it, they spent usually a significant amount of time. And I'm saying this again, but I'm bearing it for repetition. It's that the Rocky cutscene lasts 2 minutes in movies and might last 5 years for most people, or 10. And I remember my neighbor, I met him, he was 15 years old. He now works for us at acquisition.com. But this is a cool story. So he's 15 years old and he's like, I want to be an entrepreneur. And so he worked out with me every day for a couple of years at my home gym. And so
Is he Jack now?
never more Jack than me. And so he then goes to college. And after his first semester, he's like, I don't know, like this is, you know, I'm studying business. And I was like, dude, are you willing in this or not? Are you really doing this? And he was like, well, you know, school's not really blah, blah, blah. And I said, the world doesn't need another 3-1 business degree. Either crush school or don't go. If your goal is entrepreneurship, he's like, well, I want to be an entrepreneur. And so I apparently told him this that he remembers because he brings it up all the time. But I said, you are afraid of going all in on entrepreneurship because staying in college is safe from an approval perspective. So you're doing all these side things, but you don't have to bear the brunt of not a failing because you're still in school.
Yeah.
It's like, so you need to get rid of
that.
You're
not all in.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so he quit school and then he started on the call floor of Gym Launch. Now,
that's not glorious.
And to be fair, to the point we're making earlier, I said, I can't get you the job. I won't give you the job. I said, I can get you an interview. I was like, it's going to be up to the sales manager and I'm not going to tell him that I know you. He was like, okay. I was like, you better be prepared. And so he did get the job. To be fair, the qualifications for frontline caller is not super high. And the reason that I started him there was because I actually walked in on him one day when he was waiting for me to go work out. And I heard him on the phone trying to do one of these wholesaling, you know, real estate deals. And I said, you know, did you close the deal? And he said, no. And he said, I'm not sure if real estate, you know, the wholesaling thing's for me. And I said, well, have you heard you on the phone? And he was like, what do you mean? I was like, you sound horrible. You can't sell anything.
You know, I'm the skill.
Of course. He said, well, how do I get good at sales? I was like, you work on a sales team with somebody who's been there before and can tell you what to do. And so I got him the interview, took the job. He became the top salesman on the setting team.
Wow.
And then he became, sorry, the outbound team. Then he went to the setting team, which is the second rung of salesman. They qualify the leads. And then became the top one there. And then he got to the top of the Christmas tree, which is closers. And then became the top closer.
He learned skills.
Out of 26 guys.
Wow.
Big team. And a lot of these are men, you know, have families, kids.
Wow. And how much can you make as a top closer?
$250
a year.
Yeah.
It's pretty good money.
Yeah, it is good money.
For a 21-year-old, 22-year-old?
Yeah.
Yeah.
19 at the time.
19, making 250?
Yeah.
That's life-changing.
Of course. And he had to learn how to talk to men. Talking to gym owners. 40-year-old gym owners, telling them how he can help them with their business.
Wow.
Right. Takes balls. And so I bring that up to say is that when you're starting out, you need to focus on learning rather than earning. Now, he obviously earned, but it was because he quickly fast-tracked his learning process. And so I think one of the biggest hacks in the world is getting paid to learn. Like right now, we have this big societal context of like, you pay in order to learn. But what if there were a world where you could get paid to learn? Well, that is what working at a company is if you're mindful of what career path you want to get into. Now, if you're like, I don't know what I want to do, then I would recommend starting with a meta skill. So sales is going to work. Like, if you learn how to sell, it'll work in any company you're in. If you learn how to market, it'll work in any company. I mean, to be fair, if you get into HR, a zillion businesses need HR stuff, if that's what you like. And if you're like, I don't know what I like. Well, you also aren't going to like anything unless you start, because we usually only like things that we're good at. And we usually aren't good at things that we start. Right? And so the only way to get good at something is to do a lot of it. And when you start, you suck. And so a lot of the time, there's this fallacy of finding the right thing or the perfect fit. But one, almost every entrepreneur that I know has had many, many, many businesses, and mostly many failures before they had their success. It's because each one of them stair-stepped. And so there's this paralysis around, like, I got to pick the right thing. And it's really, you got to pick something. And then you'll learn all the inadequacies that you have no idea about once you get into it. Like, I started a gym when I was 22 years old, like brick and mortar, signed a lease,
saved $50,000. Yeah.
It was stupid. I had no idea what I was doing, but I did sign, kudos to younger me. I had a mentor early on who was in the gym world.
That's correct.
Right?
So you could get advice and learn from.
Yes. I mean, still, it was still incredibly hard, but I was able to just get, you know, suck everything like a, you know,
fire hose,
like a vacuum cleaner, to get all the information I needed to just barely keep my head above water until, and then things started to work out, because every weekend I'd go and drive over to a gym owner and say, why do you do this? Why is your lobby like this? How many leads do you convert? How do you call it? Like, whatever. And so I just kept doing that every single weekend, because I was such a young guy. Everyone was
help this guy out. Yeah,
exactly. And I owe a lot to those older entrepreneurs who helped me out. And so in some ways, a lot of what I do at acquisition.com is kind of my small way of paying it forward.
And one of the cool things is when you're someone who's getting started and you're going out and humbly asking for advice, but you're taking the actions. Hey, I'm launching this thing. I'm taking the steps. I'm just trying to figure it out, but I'm taking the actions and I'm in the process. People usually want to give advice and support and say, hey, why don't you come check out and go out for lunch or whatever it is. But if you're just saying, I want to do this, but I'm not taking any action, people are less likely to help you. Maybe they'll help you a little bit, but they see you struggling and trying and like leaping before you're ready. It's like, all right, cool. Let's help you get it going.
I love the saying, luck favors the prepared.
Mm-hmm.
So like if you want to go ask, you know, Lewis to have you on, or to get Lewis on your show, right? Well, what do? You don't just ask Lewis. You show how much you've prepared. You say, hey, I went through 50 hours of your content. These are 9 questions that have never been asked to you before that I think would be really good. I've got two buddies of mine from college who are gonna also video it. I've got this church basement that I can get the lighting to look really cool so we can make cinematic. Because to be real, I know I don't have the audience that you have, but I can help at least give you clips that will distribute and actually convert for you. And hopefully that's enough of value add. Now, Lewis might not say yes, but if you do that 100 times, count in hundreds.
Right.
One Lewis will say yes.
Right.
And everyone loves to help people who help themselves.
Yes.
Always. Because the biggest fear that anyone who gives advice has is that someone takes the advice and does nothing.
Exactly.
Because they didn't learn. They didn't change their behavior.
That's true.
Right?
It's a waste of the time.
So you don't feel like you're teaching. You only teach if they change their behavior. If they change their behavior, they learned. And so many people like being a teacher. I think a teaching role is nice. I think most people feel good about it. But you only feel like you have a teaching role if you see a change.
And someone takes action.
Right.
Yeah.
And you can hack the whole system if you just show people that you'll take initiative.
100%. If you take, I mean, that's what happened for me early on. I was just taking a lot of action and people were like, they wanted to add me in the room. They wanted me at the table because I was willing to take action. Even though I was young and broke and struggling, they were like, hey, this guy's showing up.
Yeah.
I would go to every conference that I could in kind of the social media blogging world early on and somehow get to the late night dinners at 2 a.m. with all the speakers. And they'd be like, hey, why don't you come tag along, young guy? You know, you're bringing us a lot of joy at least, right? Even though you have no clue what you're doing, you can't offer anything else but joy.
Yeah.
But you're asking me some interesting questions that people don't.
Yeah.
So, I'm happy to talk about myself for another 20 minutes.
Totally.
And you get in the room, you get access, and you take action. People will want to keep supporting you.
Totally.
Because you're applying their teachings and people like them.